Good morning.
What a beautiful day it is to be in the house of the Lord. We've been looking at a new series. We've been looking at a Pentecostal powerhouse. What does it mean to be me? What does it mean to be a Pentecostal powerhouse? Well, when you have the idea of a powerhouse, you have that idea of that bodybuilder, that person who lifts weights, who's constantly trying to get their body built up, and they're pushing themselves, and they're pushing themselves. It's not just like some people have at New Year's, that I'm going to get into shape, or I'm going to do this, or I'm going to do that. It's not like a New Year's resolution where we start it, and about a day or two later, we quit it. But somebody who becomes a powerhouse is consistency. They're constantly pushing, they're constantly striving, they're constantly working out. And for us, that is our goal. What does it mean for us to become a Pentecostal powerhouse? And as we go farther along, we'll talk about other topics and get more in depth. But as we've been talking, we started out with faith. What is faith? When we look at the Word of God and we look at faith, we of course go to Hebrews chapter 11, verse 1. To get the definition of faith. Does anybody know off the top of their head or can read Hebrews 11 and verse 1?
Now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen.
Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. If there is ever a textbook definition of faith in the Word of God, this is exactly where it would be. If we had anything that's similar to Webster's dictionary having a definition of faith, this is probably where Webster would go, Hebrews chapter 1, because it tells us what faith is. Faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. As we dive into that verse, and I don't want to get too teachy or technical, but we find that the Greek word for substance could actually be translated confident or confidence. And we're not pulling that out of thin air, but we're taking it from that Greek word and how many times it's been used in the New Testament, which was 5, and how it was translated. And out of those 5 times, one time is translated substance, as we see in Hebrews 11 and 1, but 3 other times it was translated confident or confidence. So when we look at the way it's used, we can see from the Word of God that substance could be replaced with the word confidence. Not changing the Word of God, not taking it out of context, but it could read that faith is the confidence of things hoped for and the evidence of things not seen. When we study the word faith in the Bible and the word hope, because that word confidence or substance in 11:1 of Hebrews is connecting faith with things hoped for. And when we look at hope in the Word of God, when we look at faith in the Word of God, nowhere do we find any indication or slight hinting at the word doubt, but it's always the word confidence. When we look at the Word of God with the word hope, you're always going to find it, for the most part, surrounded by the word confidence or the idea of confidence. When we look at faith throughout the Word of God, you're always going to have it surrounded with the idea of confidence. There's never doubt. I love this phrase that I came across in the past week. John Hagee twittered it. Whether or not it originated with him, I don't know. But the phrase is, faith is not hoping God can, but knowing that God can. Faith is not hoping God can, but knowing that he can. When we look at faith, there is no indication of doubt anywhere. As we used the illustration last week of the little child, if your parent says that they're going to give you a cookie, they know without a shadow of doubt that mom or dad's going to give me a cookie. They don't doubt it in any way, but they know. They might bug you forever, mom, can I have it now? Mom, can I have it now? Can I have it now? But they know without a shadow of doubt that they're going to get the cookie. They don't know when, but they know they're going to get it. They don't doubt that, well, maybe mom's going to change her mind or dad's going to change his mind. They know. It's just a matter of when are they going to get it. That is exactly what faith is. Faith is not hoping that God can, but knowing that he can. And when we go into prayer knowing that he can instead of doubting whether or not he will, the results will change drastically. We had talked about the book of James, I believe it's chapter 1. What did James write concerning prayer and faith? He loved to use it for the person riding the fence. A double-minded man is unstable in all his ways. When you ask of God, don't ask anything wavering. And I know I have that wording off a little bit. But what does James say? Don't doubt when you ask God. But pray with confidence, knowing that you'll receive the answer. As we move on looking at faith today we're going to look at some examples. But before we do that, let me ask you this question. What do you think that God thinks when he looks at the church as a whole from heaven? What do you think? How do you think God feels? When he looks down from heaven at the church as a whole, what does God think? Any thoughts? Maybe it's not a question that we've thought before, but really, when God looks down from heaven, and he views the church as a whole, how does he feel? What does he think? Where's their faith? Maybe I've told them time and time again, but they still doubt me and they still don't believe.
Maybe they have faith 55. I don't know.
How long am I going to be with you? Let me throw out one more thing that we find in an undertone in there, Ron. How about frustration? Is God frustrated when he looks down from heaven and views the church? How else might God feel? What else might he think? I'm not looking. I'm just trying to get us thinking, because for me, this isn't something I think people think about a lot. But if we were sitting in God's position and we're looking down at the church, we know the history of the church, we know where it came from, we know the book of Acts, we know that signs and wonders shall follow and believe. Looking at a church as the whole, how does God view the church? How does he feel about the church?
He loves us. I think he wants to empower us. Heart is wrong toward us. He thinks of us.
He thinks of us. He's drawn towards us.
But he wants the people to believe.
He wants the people. Absolutely, brother. Anybody else want to throw anything in?
What is faith anymore? Today, faith to people is not always God. It's going to stop. It goes out there. It used to be that when somebody be sick or something, they would come in and the pastor or preacher would lay their hands on them and they'd be looked just like that. Nowadays, it's not like that anymore.
No, it's not.
Because I remember the day back, you know, they would come in the church and say, you have to ask for them. The pastor would just lay their hands on them and say, in the name of Jesus. When he goes to the hospital, one woman said, I had an ulcer in my therapy, but she's going to have a life. And the pastor said, what are you going to have in with you? And the pastor said, in the name of Jesus. And people don't do that anymore. They say that they have faith, but yet, as soon as something happens, they pray a little bit, but right away, they go to the doctor or whatever, you know. But hey, I've been going all these years without doctors or hospitals or any kind of medication. Because Jesus has always been my Lord. And he always will be.
Absolutely.
Until the day of the Lord comes. And I almost died already. But it would
just throwing this out, and we'll move here a little bit, but she's trying to get us to think, if we were sitting in God's position, or how, or even if not, if we're just looking at it from God's looking down on the church, how do you think he feels about the church today? We've already talked about lack of faith. I remember reading here in the last couple of months about a gentleman who used to pastor in Somerset, Pennsylvania. And he said that one day he had a vision of Jesus Christ at the whipping post. And after that vision, you know, he got rid of all his medicine. They didn't go to the doctors more than they had to. I mean, they had a few minor surgeries, but other than that, they didn't live on medicine. They got rid of it completely. But when we look at the Word of God, Christ, God shouldn't have to give everyone a vision like that. He really shouldn't. And the reason for that being is, he's already instructed us in our work. If a child comes running to mom or dad asking them if they can have something, one of the first questions you're probably going to ask them is, especially if it's near supper time, well, what did mom or what did the other spouse say? Mom can answer, well, what did dad say? You're taking them on their word. When it comes to the Word of God, if we take it by faith the way that we're supposed to be, God shouldn't have to give us a vision about every little thing. He's already told us, he's already instructed us. Now moving on from, how do you think God looks down upon the church? If he views the church from heaven right now, how does it make him feel? But if God would look down from heaven on Miracle Bible Church, and this is just being rhetorical from here on out, how do you think God feels about Miracle Bible Church? What do you think would be going through his mind? Would he be disappointed? Would he be frustrated? Would he be happy with some things, but upset with other things? Would he want to intervene more, but maybe people are hindering from it and not allowing him? Maybe there's a lack of faith in some areas, because we can have faith in some areas and not faith in the other areas. I mean, I can have faith that God's going to take care of all my finances, Brother Eli, but I might not have enough faith for my healing. You know, it can vary.
The main thing is not to look at our people in it, but the main thing is that they feel they're all unto Jesus.
Absolutely.
But our name, they come in here. Do not give it all before it. Oh, when something happens, no, then they want to pray. But when everything is normal and good, then they don't pray anymore.
Absolutely.
But the main thing is, we've got to look to Jesus for every day of our life. Do you never know?
Oh, you don't.
And the Lord, he'll take care of us. He'll keep us. But why do we want Jesus if we only half heartedly fear the Lord and other half not?
And that brings us into our next rhetorical question. We've looked at, how does God view the church as a whole? How does it make him feel as he looks down from heaven? We looked at, when God looks down from heaven, what might he think or feel towards Miracle Bible Church? But when God looks down from heaven, how does he feel about us individually as a Christian? Because that's where it begins. I can't control you. You can't control me. I can't make you do anything. I can't make you serve God. I can't make you step out in faith. I can encourage you, but I can't make you do it. When God looks down from heaven and he looks at you in the spectrum of Christianity, in the spectrum of the early church, in the spectrum of, this is what he's already told us in his word, signs and wonders shall follow them which believe.
Amen.
They shall lay hands on the sick and they shall recover. For those who do not have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, if you fall in that category, are you actively seeking the Holy Ghost? When God looks down, if you're not, how do you think that makes him feel? If you have the baptism of the Holy Ghost, are you being used in the gifts of the Spirit? Are you learning, allowing the Holy Ghost to teach you to be used in that gift or gifts of the Holy of the Spirit? If God looks down on each one of us individually, what do you think He thinks about each one of us? Now, no one else, us, me. How does God think about you just as an individual, as a quote-unquote Christian? Are we lining up with the Word of God? Are we laying hands on the sick? Are we having the signs and wonders follow? This has been a question that I've pondered quite a bit. And I'll be honest, sometimes I wonder if God is just sitting on His throne in heaven saying, I don't care if you even mess up, just try something. I don't care if you even doubt a little bit, just lay hands on the sick to try to see them recover. Ever get that frustrated with somebody that, I don't care if you even mess it up, just at least try? Is that how God feels about the church? Is that how God feels about Miracle Bible Church? Is that how God feels about us on an individual level? Now, do we need to step outside of our comfort zone? What are we doing? Are we seeing signs and wonders follow? We can come to Sunday school all we want. We can try to learn the Word of God all we want. We can be deep in the things of God and still sit on our pews and do nothing and frustrate God. Do we frustrate God at times? How do you think that God looks at you? If we look at Matthew 25, verses 14 through 30, and I'll go ahead and read that. Matthew 25, 14 through 30. Matthew 25, verses 14 through 40, Jesus speaking. For the kingdom of heaven is as a man traveling into a far country, who called his own servants and delivered unto them his goods. And unto one he gave 5 talents, to another 2, and to another 1, to every man according to his several ability. And straightway he took his journey. Then he that had received the 5 talents went and traded them with the same, and made them other 5 talents. And likewise he that had received 2, he also gained other 2. But he that had received 1 went and digged in the earth and hid his Lord's money. And after a long time, the Lord of those servants cometh and reckoneth with them. And so he that had received 5 talents came and brought other 5 talents, saying, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 5 talents. Behold, I have gained beside them 5 talents more. His Lord said unto him, Well done, thou good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. He that had received 2 talents came and said, Lord, thou deliverest unto me 2 talents. Behold, I gained 2 other talents beside them. His Lord said unto him, Well done, good and faithful servant. Thou hast been faithful over a few things. I will make thee ruler over many things. Enter thou into the joy of the Lord. Then he which had received this 1 talent came and said, Lord, I knew that thou art an hard man, reaping where thou hast not sown and gathering where thou hast not strawed. And I was afraid and went and hid thy talent in the earth. Lo, thou hast that is thine. His Lord answered and said unto him, Thou wicked and slothful servant, thou knewest that I reap where I sowed not, and gather where I have not strawed. Thou oughtest therefore to have put my money to the exchangers, and then at my coming I should have received my own with usury. Take therefore the talent from him, and give it unto him which hath 10 talents. For unto every one that hath shall be given, and he shall have an abundance. But from him that hath not shall be taken away, even that which he hath. And cast ye the unprofitable servant into outer darkness, there shall be weeping and gnashing of teeth. When we look at this passage, each man was given something. 2 went outside of their comfort zone, and they did something with it. And the one took what they were given, kept it, dug it in the earth. Do we do that with the things of God? Do we take that one thing that God's given us and we hide it within ourselves, or we just keep it to ourselves, and we don't step outside our comfort zone. He said, give and it shall be given unto you. Are we looking for opportunities to give to the poor? I'm not looking for talking about those who don't need it and they go begging for money in it. Someone who really, really needs it. Do we attempt to lay hands on the sick if we see someone sick that they might recover? Do we take God at his word? Or do we just sit there and do nothing? Faith takes action. If we're going to see results, it takes action. Even if you say, I'm not a preacher, I'm not a speaker, but you can still pray for someone. If we look at these talents, well, God really hasn't given me anything. He's given you life. Can you at least tell somebody about Christ and try to win them for him? Now, what are we doing with what God has given us? Are we seeing them multiply and we're using them? Or are we hiding them within ourselves? When we look at, there was a book written many years ago called Silence by a Japanese author, Shusaka Endo. He was a Catholic, and what he was doing was he was trying to study this history, the history of Catholicism in Japan. And his conclusion was that Japan took the Catholic religion and they took what they liked about it, but they got rid of the rest. He called it a marshland. Japan was a nation or a culture that was compared to marshland. Didn't matter what it was, they took what they liked about it, but they got rid of the rest. If we look at America today, we cannot call America a marshland. We really can't. They're tolerant of every other religion but Christianity. They don't absorb what they like and get rid of what they don't like. But rather, they pick and choose. And when it comes to Christianity, they don't pick it apart. But rather, we're all right to enter into a church for the time being, as long as we don't get too religious. Christianity is tolerable as long as we're not laying hands on the sick to see them recover. Christianity is tolerable until we tell them what the Word of God states concerning homosexuality. Then all of a sudden, it's a hate crime. We're not living in the same culture that Endo wrote about in Japan. But we see a nation that is completely opposed to true Christianity. The last couple of weeks, I played portions of a compilation of sermons and messages, and they sent it to music, and they called it the Martyr's Prayer. At one point, if you listen to that whole thing, it is on YouTube, there's a small snippet in there where a preacher is preaching, where he states, and I'm trying to get it right, that Christianity in America is going to become violently, people are going to become violently opposed to it because there's going to come a point in time where the Christian gospel is going to get extremely radical, like in the book of Acts. America is tolerating Christianity right now because the majority of the churches, what do? How many signs are we seeing falling? How many wonders are we seeing happening? How active are these churches in spiritual things? But what we need is a revival like none other. And where does revival begin? It's not going to start with the Christian church as a whole. It's going to begin in us. And either revival is going to come or persecution is going to come. But God throughout America has already started weeding out the true church. When we look at, I believe it's the book of Ezekiel, where did judgment begin? It began at the house of God. God's been mocked enough times through the Christian church. Why? Because we do not display the power of God. The power is ours. The power is all God's. Don't get me wrong. When we pray with somebody that miraculously get healed, it's not because of us. We were just obedient, and we were the will of the vessel. But it's the power of God being displayed. The lame man at the gate, beautiful. When he was healed, they didn't say that Peter and John healed them. But they persecuted those men because of the power that came through them. And why was it such a big deal? Because when the power of God is at work, there's not a single man on this earth, alive or dead, that can prove that it wasn't God. In fact, there's not a man, dead or alive, that can deny that it wasn't God. Because when God moves, there's no denying who it came through. It came from God Almighty. It's time for us to get back to our roots. Like I said, we can go deep into the Word of God. We can understand this. We can understand that. We can talk about all we want, how Melchizedek was a type of Christ, or how Isaac was a type of Christ. We can look at the tabernacle and talk about this type and that type and show how it reflected Christ. We can know the Bible inside and out. But if we do not step out of faith, if we do nothing, God is still displeased. Because he's looking for an active church. He's looking for us to get back to our roots. And it all begins with you and I. We have to get outside of our comfort zone. And if we are going to become a Pentecostal powerhouse, we need to start now. What do I mean by that? The person who works out is not the person who goes to the gym for 3 days and quits after New Year's. But it's consistent. Why? Because they desire change. They have that desire. They have that motivation. If we are going to be used in the things of God, if we're going to grow in faith, if we're going to see signs and wonders, we have to have a desire. If we do not desire to go deeper in God, if we do not have a desire for us as individuals to get back to the book of Acts, it's not going to happen. The Sunday school teacher can teach all he or she wants. The pastor can preach all he or she wants. It comes back to our desire. The Bible does not state, blessed is the church who hungers and thirsts after righteousness. But he said, blessed are they. Blessed are you if you hunger and thirst after righteousness. It comes down to us on an individual level. If we go through the book of Acts, if we go through the book of Hebrews chapter 11, the very first thing that he does is he starts listing individuals, not groups, but individuals that walk through faith. In Hebrews chapter 11 and verse 4, the Bible states, by faith Abel offered unto God a more excellent sacrifice than Cain, by which he obtained witness that he was righteous. That he was righteous, God testifying of his gifts, and by it he being dead, yet speaking. It wasn't his whole family or everybody alive at the time or those that did right. But God began listing individuals that practice faith. Why? Because it comes down to you and I as individuals. And if we're going to be used in the gifts of the Spirit, guess what component it starts with? Well,